I had a very interesting conversation on the phone this past week with a gentleman whose name is Mark Glidewell. Mark is a cooperative individual with Bob Brown. Is that correct? Bob Brown. And they're very much concerned about what's going on in this country. And he offered this as his bio for me. I was born in Ripley and currently live in Batesville, Mississippi. My father was a Baptist minister, a school teacher, and my mother was a school teacher. Both have retired in the past few years. I'm 42 years old, married with three children. I graduated from Charleston High School and attended the nursing program at Northwest Community College, but nursing wasn't for me. By day, I worked for the railroad, and in the other 16 hours, I worked towards mine and my children's future. For the last 20 years, myself and my closest friends spent much of our free time figuring out what was this country coming to and what we were going to do about it. And it finally dawned on us that nothing was going to be done if we didn't start stepping forward ourselves. This day is going to be a little bit about how one person can make a difference by connecting with others. And as I said to you, Mississippi Tea Party is trying to get people connected. That's one of the things that I'm really trying to do. After seeking out other militias and various groups, we decided in 2013 that we would do our own. We wanted a group of like-minded individuals who were willing to stand up and do what was necessary just because it's right. No opportunity in secret, no operating in secret, and no backing down, regardless of the consequences. So this is the person who was revealed to me. I'm trying to remember, Mark, where you came from, how I got in touch with you.
Through Robert.
Okay. And so we have Mark, who comes from way up in northern Mississippi, and is going to join us.
No. Where? Very beginning. That's why you hang out with me. I got a brand new car.
Just close it up.
It's great to see all y'all here today, and it's a pleasure to be here and speak to you. I talk kind of loud naturally, so I'm going to move this out of the way a little bit. Citizens Militia Mississippi was started 3 years ago. I'm here to represent them today, and I'm proud to. as she said, we decided that at the end of the day, if nobody stepped up, we were going to have to. I mean, there's pockets of people everywhere that are making some noise. But the truth is, most of our state, most of our country is still left complaining to their friends. That's not going to cut it. We're not going to change anything sitting around over a cup of coffee complaining every day that things aren't going right. If we want to see a difference made, we have to be the difference ourselves. It has to start with us. And that's where we began. I was asked today to talk about the relationship with the sheriffs. Many of you probably have heard that the county sheriff has more authority than the president of the United States. A lot of you may not know why. That is not a myth, it is true.
That's right.
The office of the sheriff has more authority than the governor or the president of the United States. So I want to talk to you about the sheriffs for just a moment. Where did the sheriffs come from? Let's go back to England over 1,000 years ago. The king would write executive orders, I mean laws, he would write laws. And he would hand them down to his men who would go out across the countryside, and they would enforce these laws. As they did that, representing the king, they would cross the town. That time the counties were called shires. go through the Shire, and anything they needed, they would stop and take it. Because they were the king's men, they could do that. Nobody could touch it. They needed food for their horses, they got it. Needed food for themselves, they took it. They needed a place to stay. They kicked you out of your house, they took it. They needed money, whatever they needed, they took it. Eventually, the people realized that no one else was going to help them, so they stepped up themselves. They decided to get together and hire a man to come in and to train some people inside the county. Train them to fight, if necessary. This man was called a reeve. That's what he did. He trained these men up to be a fighting force. And as the king's men would come across the land, they would get word that he was coming. They would meet him at the county line. They would say, wait a minute, you're not coming here without a fight. Take a guess at what happened when they had to fight for what they got. They went around that county. They went to the next county where there wasn't anybody to protect them. These men became known as Shire Reeves. And it was in 1215. Magna Carta was signed that it was actually established as British common law, and through the preceding legal documents after the Magna Carta. So it's actually been around on paper for 800 years, which in case you didn't know, this is the 800 year anniversary of the Magna Carta. A lot of our ideals and family documents came from that time period. When our forefathers, when they were framing the Constitution, they put in a lot of checks and balances. You know, the most that we talk about the federal government is divided in three parts, the legislative, the judicial, and I'm trying to forget about that.
Keep all that shit.
Well, what we don't always talk about is the division, probably the most important division. It's what makes us a republic. It's what makes us a federal republic. It's the division between the state and the federal government. See, that power is divided so that neither one trumps the other when they're inside their sphere of authority. In other words, by the Constitution, the federal government doesn't have the right to come into a state and tell that state what they have to do. The state doesn't have the right to go into the federal government when they're operating inside their constitutional limited authority. The state does not have the right to go tell them what to do. Without that sharing of power, this constitutional federal republic would never have existed. The Constitution wouldn't have been signed. A lot of people say the federal government's taking this freedom away, they've taken that freedom, they've taken power from the states, but I would submit to you today that the federal government hasn't taken anything from us. We've given it to us. Piece by piece, year by year, we give them a little more. At any time, the state so decides, it can't take that power back. It's what CMM believes, it's what I believe, that the battle for our country, this battle that we're fighting right now, it doesn't start in Washington, D.C. I love the term grassroots, because that is absolutely what it has to be. You know, the way federalism works, it starts at the bottom and it goes to the top. The power is all at the bottom, at the roots, and it goes to the top. And now, these days, it seems we live in a national society where everything starts at the top and gets filtered down to the bottom. But that's not the way it was intended to be. If we're going to make a difference, it starts in Mississippi. To be more exact, it starts in your county. So the question is how do we make a difference in our county? What can we do? I would suggest that we take a lesson from the the English 800 years ago. They stood up to hire the Sharif. We have sheriffs, and it's a constitutional provision. The state of Mississippi, our constitution, gives them that authority. They are not law enforcement officers. You know, there's a difference between a peace officer and a law enforcement officer. The sheriff is not bound to listen to state or federal bureaucrats. They don't have to. They swear an oath to the Constitution, and they are bound to follow the Constitution. At any point in time that any official comes to that sheriff and tells them that they're going to do something that is contrary to the Constitution, then they have the authority, not only the authority, but the duty to say no. We're not going to do that. We're not going to do that here in this county. To give you an example, most of you are probably familiar with Sheriff Richard Mack, Arizona. Him and Jay Prince from Montana put this to the test. Y'all remember the Brady Bill? Some alphabet agency came across, came down and told these sheriffs they were going to enforce this new federal regulations that was placed on firearms. The sheriffs got together, scratched their head, and said, you know what, sounds like a violation of the Second Amendment to me. We're not going to do it. So they took him to court, went all the way to the Supreme Court, and they won. It's not the only case, there's more. The courts have traditionally upheld the authority of the sheriff. One of the Federalist Paper 39, James Madison wrote, and I'll quote this to you, the local or municipal authorities form distinct and independent portions of the supremacy. No more subject within their respective spheres to the general authority than the general authority is subject to them within its own sphere. James Madison made it very clear that there was a separation between the state and the federal government. Using Madison's words, the court came to the decision and pounded home the fact that yes, the sheriff does have the authority to uphold the Constitution regardless of who is handing him down a line. They had a bridge that had fallen down and needed repair. Sheriff Max County. They got the lawmakers together, the city officials. These people were driving 26 miles to get their children to school. They decided they would raise the money and rebuild the bridge themselves because the Corps of Engineers told them it would take 10 years. They had to do environmental impact studies and all these other things. They raised the money themselves, and when they did, the EPA showed up and said, oh, no. You start building that bridge, we're going to fine you $50,000 a day. Sheriff Max said, you have a bridge, let me have it there. He met him at the county line. He showed him the door out. He stood up for his people. That's what your sheriff should do. If you don't know your sheriff, you need to know your sheriff. He's one of our last lines of defense. Next to us, the people, he is. Why it's very important that we vet our sheriffs. When they run for election, we need to know who they are. We need to know what they stand for. But I'm going to tell y'all what. It's not good enough to just elect good people to office. It's not enough. That may be hard enough, but that's not enough. We have to be there for them every day. Once they're elected, once they're in that position, we have to be there not only to keep them on the right track, but to support them, to help them every step of the way. If they would like to stand up for your rights, your constitutional rights, and it's only them and four or five deputies, how much standing do you think they'll do? This is one area that the CMM is happy to be a part of. We're available to them. All they have to do is call us. Any sheriff picks up the phone and calls us, he knows that we'll be there within an hour. We'll be be there and ready to do whatever he needs done. I'm gonna leave y'all with this. It seems bad, the situation that we're in today. Sometimes you wanna just throw your hands up, you wanna say, this can't be done. It's gone too far. Freedom's lost. But I want y'all to think about it. When has freedom ever been secure? 1776, we call it a bloody revolution. 1812, we did it again. 1861, Reconstruction that followed that. 1914 brought us World War I, 39 brought us World War II. The 50s and 60s brought about global communism. The 80s, Cold War, I remember that well. There has never been a point where freedom hasn't been in danger. The only difference today is it's our turn. So let's step up. Thank you all.